Welcome to Artix 8-Bit Bytes. This week, I'm working on a new sports bar, and I wanted to share a bit about the video system that I'm setting up and how I had to configure two Netgear AV switches to make it all work. So, here we go. There are four things you should know when linking multiple Netgear AV switches. Now, here's my disclaimer. I'm not a networking guru, and I'm definitely not a replacement for Netgear's excellent training resources, but I can walk you through some of the challenges that I ran into and maybe help you avoid a few headaches if you're doing something similar. So, worst case, you'll learn a few key ideas and what to look out for. The first thing you need to know, it's all about smart data management and using the Netgear's auto trunk and auto lag settings. The sports bar is using a Crestron NVX video over IP system. They have 12 cable boxes and a couple other HDMI sources feeding into NVX encoders. On the other end, there are over 60 NVX decoders behind displays, all receiving the 14 data streams. Since each encoder can push up to 1 gigabit per second of data, 14 encoders could mean up to 14 gigs of video traffic. Now, that's a lot of data. Because of the number of endpoints, I had to use two Netgear switches. I put 7 encoders on each switch to split the load. This puts 7 gigs of data that can travel each way across the links. Another tricky part was getting all that data between the switches and having the right settings. Now, this is actually pretty easy with the Netgears. Most models have several 10 gig SFP plus ports, and I use two copper 10 gig modules to create a 20 gig link between the switches. You need to make sure that auto trunk and auto lag are enabled on both switches. Now, auto trunk, it automatically configures VLAN trunking between the switches. And auto lag, that detects the physical connections between the switches and distributes the load between the two SFPs. Both of these are usually enabled, but you need to make sure that they're both running on both switches. Now, the second thing you need to know, Netgear AV switches have built-in config files ready to go. They have partnered with companies like Crestron, QSIS, and Visionary Solutions to have pre-made switch setups made specifically for their products. On each Netgear switch, I loaded a Netgear built-in config file designed specifically for Crestron NVX. And this Crestron config file is actually something new that popped up on one of the latest firmware versions. They also have other config files for video over IP systems like QSIS and Visionary Solutions. The config turns on all the right settings. IGMP Snooping, jumbo frames, the quality of service settings, and many other stuff, just to make sure that the multicast video works smoothly. I created a VLAN 2 on each switch using the Crestron NVX config. And here's a tip. Make sure you hit save every time you make a change. The Netgear doesn't automatically save everything, and if the switch ever reboots, you'll lose all these settings. So, in the upper right, click Save. The third thing you need to know, because IGMP snooping is enabled by loading one of the video config files, you need to have at least one IGMP Querier enabled, but just one, not on both. What is IGMP Querier? Querier is something that needs to run alongside IGMP snooping. And Querier asks the devices on the network if they want to receive multicast traffic, like the decoders. It manages the multicast group memberships. You need to have at least one Querier running, but only one. If you have two, they conflict and things can get weird fast. The Querier also needs an IP address. So if the switch's VLAN 1 management IP address is a 10.0.0.5, I'll use the next IP. I'll assign the Querier the address of 10.0.0.6. The switch will use this Querier IP during its multicast election process. Here's a little gotcha that I've run into with the Netgear AV switches. There's an OOB port on the switch for connecting to its management webpage. If you plug your laptop into it and reboot the switch, you can access the webpage at 192.168.0.239. But here's the real catch. If you reboot the switch and you don't have anything plugged into that port, it sometimes will not go to this default IP. So, either way, it's super handy, but it can make you a little lazy. I've definitely skipped setting an IP on VLAN 1 because I figured, hey, I've got the OOB port to talk to instead, so why would I do that? But here's the final catch. If you don't assign an IP to VLAN 1, the switch won't activate IGMP Querier when you create VLAN 2 for your video traffic. And without a Querier, IGMP snooping won't work. So here's what I do. I usually leave port 1 alone and on VLAN 1. I assign it an IP address, and I use that as a backup way to manage the switch, along with a OOB port. Then I create VLAN 2 for the video system on all the other ports. After that, I make sure that I click into VLAN 2, its settings, just to double check that you have a Querier running. Now, the switch won't always do it for you, and like I said, there's some catches there, and I've been burned on it more than once. So I'm going to say this one more time. Always make sure you only have one Querier running, and only one. And one last reminder, always click save after making all these changes. So the last thing you need to know is tagged versus untagged traffic. Tagged traffic is for the SFP or trunk ports when data leaves the switch. Tagged traffic carries its VLAN information, so when it hits the other switch, it knows what VLAN the traffic is a part of. Untagged traffic is for local devices that don't need to have VLAN information. Untagged traffic is usually local and on the same VLAN. So for example, I'd have a control processor and a touchscreen, both on the same VLAN. Having untagged traffic and having those ports untagged would be the way to go. One thing to watch out for, when you create VLAN 2, Netgear likes to default all its ports on that new VLAN to untagged. So that's fine if everything stays on the switch. But if your video traffic goes out through an SFP port to another switch, those packets need to be tagged. Otherwise, the second switch won't know what VLAN they belong to. So when you set up VLAN 2, make sure the ports that connect to the other switches are set to tagged. It's easy to miss, but incredibly important. Okay, so here's the final recap. Save, 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 save. Always hit save after any change and every change. Auto trunk and auto leg need to be on. They need to be on both switches. Querier needs to be running on only one switch and only one. Make sure the traffic that leaves a switch is tagged data. All other ports are untagged. I hope that this information was helpful and that you can take this information and reapply it on your next project. Thanks for watching Artix 8-Bit Bytes, where I'm pleased to be your Internet AV engineering and programming resource. If you enjoyed this video, please click like and subscribe for more AV-related content. Thank you.